Hi, this is Stu Turgel, your host of The Phoenix File, a weekly news magazine and community conversation with the people and programs making a positive impact on the quality of life in our community. Pregnancy, by design, is meant to be experienced in the context of family. But for women where the traditional family support system may not exist, there is Maggie's Place, a network of homes offering an alternative yet dynamic and vibrant family life. Maggie's Place provides for the physical and emotional needs of pregnant women in homes where pregnant guests live in community. Maggie's Place opens the doors of its houses of hospitality and ongoing support to help pregnant and parenting women who are in need to reach their goals and welcomes them into a community filled with love and dignity. On tonight's edition of The Phoenix File, I'll be talking with Julie Carlberg, Chief Programs Officer at Maggie's House. That's coming up next, right here on Radio Phoenix, where the Valley comes to talk, sing, connect. Good evening, I'm Stu Turgel, your host of The Phoenix File. This is a weekly news magazine that features the people and programs making a positive difference on the quality of life in the Valley of the Sun. Now, for young women who are on their own without a solid support system and network of family and friends, life sure can be full of challenges. Now, add pregnancy to the situation, and what might otherwise be a manageable level of stress can feel overwhelming and sometimes even hopeless. But for women facing such a challenge alone, there is an oasis of hope in the Valley, and that's Maggie's Place. My guest tonight is Julie Carlberg, the Chief Program Officer for Maggie's Place. Julie's been with Maggie's Place for the past 4 years. Before that, she was an educator in the Kansas City area. Julie has a bachelor's and master's degree in education from the University of Kansas. Julie Carlberg, thanks for being here tonight, and welcome to The Phoenix File.
Thank you. Thanks for having us come here tonight and be a part of your community.
Well, great. Julie, let's begin by having you tell us about Maggie's Place's mission and its core values.
Yeah, so Maggie's Place's mission is to really provide life-changing programs and services for pregnant and parenting women and their children. So we start by offering them a warm and welcoming community. So part of our foundation of our core values is really offering love and hospitality. So our shelters are actual homes in neighborhoods, as well as our Family Resource Center is an actual home in a neighborhood, and it's a very welcoming environment. If you came into our lobby, it would be full of families interacting. We have bottles of water. We have bookshelves full of free books. We have, you know, free family dental supplies. You would be greeted with a hug instead of a clipboard and a sign-in. And we just really work to uphold the dignity of every woman and child that comes in our doors.
Love and hospitality.
Yes.
That's a terrific recipe for the success that you've had over the years. And you have some values that, mm-hmm. that really speak to who and what you are. And the values of an organization really are so important. You want to tell us a little bit about some of those?
Yeah. So in addition to providing a safe place to live, we also want to provide a safe place for families to learn and receive ongoing services. So once you enter one of our shelters, after you no longer need housing with us, you still remain a part of our community forever and ever. Amen. So it doesn't matter if you live with us for one night or for 9 months, you're always a part of our community and you can always receive services at the Family Resource Center. So one thing that we really know is that women who have faced trauma and poverty and addiction oftentimes have a lot of social isolation. And so we really work to create a strengthened community for families to really live and learn and grow. So that could look like, you know, this weekend we have Earth Day Crafts at our Family Resource Center. So it's just coming and having a warm homemade meal, having a playground to play at with your kids that's a safe place, having, you know, a opportunity to have a free parent-child positive experience together and to connect with other women that are also experiencing things that you may be experiencing. Right before I walked out our doors to come here tonight, there was 21 moms and 30 kids at our family resource center that were getting ready to have the kids were doing a book, a story time book, and the moms were doing a yoga class. So
something for everybody.
Yeah.
Well, where does the name come from? Who was Maggie?
Yeah, so Maggie's Place was founded on Catholic social teachings and Catholic social justice, and really that idea that we need to live with the poor in community with the poor. And so it's actually the biblical reference to Mary Magdalene.
Oh, there wasn't a young woman by the name of Maggie that
no,
walked in.
No, but we were actually founded by five young college graduates who had graduated from school in Arizona. They were young women, just graduated from college, and they really saw, they had graduated, a lot of them were in social work, and they had saw this gap and services for pregnant women. They found a lot of other housing, and that's sort of how they started the first house.
Well, Maggie's Place says of itself that it has grown to become one community, many homes, which I think is wonderful. You told us a little bit about the story of Maggie's Place and how it got its start. But I bet a lot has evolved over, what is it, 15 years or so?
Yeah, 17 years.
17 years.
Yeah.
What have been some of the greatest changes that have taken place from the time the door first opened?
Yeah, so we first started with one home in the Phoenix area, in the Garfield area, and we currently have five homes in the Phoenix area. So we have Tempe, Mesa, Glendale, and two in Phoenix. The most recent home that we just opened is a house that, so we found that there's this great gap in housing where if your children are taken into DCS custody because you can't care for them at the moment.
Department of Child Services.
Department of Child Services, yeah. Then you a lot of times will lose your housing, or you're unable to get housing for families. But in order to be working to get your kids back out of foster care system and reunited with you, you have to have housing. So we opened our fifth home for women who are working to reunite with their children in foster care.
Julie, you have a really unique model at Maggie's Place, which I'd like to hear a little bit more about.
Yeah, so one thing that we really believe is that if you're going to have life-changing programs, you have to have both prevention and intervention. You have to help people become resilient, you have to help families stay together, and you have to really provide for both that trauma that they've been through, you have to be culturally sensitive, you have to meet them where they're at, and you have to build trust. So we have something that I call our secret sauce of Maggie's Place, and we staff all of our homes with live-in volunteers. So they give a year of service. It's very similar to doing like AmeriCorps experience. And they come and they live actually in our homes, and they live with the poor for a year. And they really are that like cheerleader at home, like that all the time. I call them that like one kind voice. Like if you can be that person's one kind voice in the world. So they may have had this day where they had a bad job interview or a hard doctor's appointment, or you know, they're having a hard day staying sober. So how can they really focus on like walking through that with them and cheerleading from them and being cheerleading them on and being that one kind voice?
Well, that's an incredible model to have volunteers to live in the houses. I mean, there are group homes that have professionals or staff people that live in the homes, but they're compensated. To have volunteers, who are these people? Where do they come from? Give me the classic profile of,
yeah,
of them.
So most of them are recent college graduates that have decided to give a year of service, and we partner with the ASU School of Social Work, and they do get a part-time Ed Award, and we're working to get AmeriCorps funding really hard with the State Office of Youth, Faith, and Family. And we do as well offer a very professional model as well. So all of our clients receive case management, they receive counseling, they receive lots of professional services as well. But I think what really does make us unique is the relationships that they have, what we call them our mission core, with our mission core in the homes. And, you know, sometimes it's just having someone to hold your baby so you can take a shower or take a nap or make a meal.
The little things.
Yeah, the little things.
That need attention. You offer a wide variety of services to your guests, and these services are offered free of charge. So what can one of your guests expect when they come to Maggie's Place?
Yeah, well, the first thing they can expect is to always be treated with dignity. And then following that, like I said, we have case management. We call it family coaching. We have counseling. We have family therapy. We have parenting classes. We have crib safety, car seat safety, CPR, first aid. We have classes like yoga. We have just positive parenting classes. Every Monday night, the guests in our home eat dinner together and really model the family environment. And then we have community volunteers that do a 24-week a year mentoring program. Every Tuesday night, we have educational classes. And every Thursday night, we have support group. And then we have a client-led addiction support group as well. And then most Saturdays are filled with, you know, the fun parent-child activities. I think we're having Cinco de Mayo coming up. We're having a big Mother's Day brunch, different things like that.
How many guests can you accommodate throughout your five separate houses?
Yes, about 40.
At a time?
At a time, and we house about 85 a year.
And so a mom mm-hmm. Who is pregnant mm-hmm. when she comes to you
correct.
May have a child or two.
Mm-hmm.
And so the children are staying there with her?
No. So it's actually, if a mom is pregnant, then they're eligible to do an intake with us. And then if they have other children, they just can't be in their immediate custody. So if they have a grandparent they can stay with, or if they're in foster care, they can stay with them. And then we do have that fifth location that if they are in foster care and they're working to reunite with them, then when they do reunite, they can stay in that location.
So how does a pregnant mom in need of help get assistance from Maggie's Place? How do women find their way to you, and what happens once that first contact is made? And what will their experience be like when they become guests at Maggie's Place?
Yeah, so people can find us online. We have, you know, an intake number that we use. We work with the continuum of care and the family housing hub, and we have a mutual referral with them. So once someone calls us, they do an initial screening and then just a quick over the phone, and then they would do an intake at our main office. And then if we had space available, then they would if they went through the intake, they could move in from there.
Why don't you mentioned that you could be contacted by phone or online, so can you give us your phone number and your website so that people will know how to find you?
Yeah, so if you're in need of shelter, you can call us at 602-246-3724, and you can find us online at www.maggiesplace.org.
All right, we're going to take a short break for some messages and then more of my conversation with Julie Carlberg. You're listening to The Phoenix File. I'm Stu Turgel, and this is Radio Phoenix. File. I'm your host, Stu Turgel, and in the studio tonight with me is my guest, Julie Carlberg, and now more of our conversation about Maggie's Place. Julie, how do women qualify to get help from Maggie's Place?
Yeah, women just need to be 18 or over and be pregnant, and they need to be not fleeing immediate domestic violence. They can have it in their past, but it can't be active because, like I said, we're homes and in neighborhoods. And then their other children have to be able to be in the care of someone else.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned before that you have five locations, five separate houses.
Mm-hmm.
Are they all similar in size or design?
Yes. Yep, they're all similar.
Kind of describe, if we were to take a virtual walkthrough, remember this is radio, so
yeah.
You have to be kind of descriptive. What does it feel like when you're in the building?
Yeah, if you would probably feel like you were in a house in a regular neighborhood, and moms, when they come in and they are pregnant, they share a bedroom with another mom. And then as they move towards getting ready to deliver the baby, then we try to place them in their own bedroom with the baby. It's a regular kitchen. There could be someone cooking dinner. There could be someone there having coffee. Like I said, we have our mission course. So someone's always on duty at our house. So someone is always there to offer a helping hand, sit and listen, and just really be present to the women that are living with us. There's a counseling room. There's a backyard. There's a garden. Mm-hmm. There's, you know, it's decorated with really uplifting decor.
How long can moms and their babies stay with you?
They can stay until the baby's 9 months old.
Well, that's quite a while.
Yeah, at any point
in
their pregnancy.
So how early in their they can come?
At any point when they have a positive pregnancy test.
So they could be with you a year and a half.
Yeah, our average stay is about five and a half months. Mm-hmm. But yeah, some people could be with us for up to a year and a half.
Well, what happens to these moms and their babies once they leave you?
We work with them, and they work a lot with their case manager to really have a positive place environment to move into next. That's something they meet with their case manager every other week, and that's something that we're working on with them the whole time. And we're actually in the process and hope to be partnering soon with Catholic Charities to open a transitional apartment. That's one of our goals for 2018. So we're working on securing funding, and then we're hoping to offer that to have sort of an extension where moms could go to live for up to 2 years.
Where does the funding come from that you're not charging these moms anything, and it's not an inexpensive proposition
yes.
to maintain all this great staff and the houses? How does it all get financed?
Yeah, so we take both private donations, a lot of individual contributions. We are eligible for the charitable tax credit mm-hmm. in Arizona. We also accept grant funding from cities and state municipalities, and then just working with a lot of different funders throughout the city.
It's a daunting task to raise as much money as it takes to keep the place going.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, but our goal is that hopefully when women come to us, they can take a break and take a breath and really work on healing first and really feeling that safe and security that they need. And then we start to work on, once we've established that and we're meeting their mental and behavioral health needs and we're meeting their physical needs, then we can really work on job readiness or going to school. And then as their baby's born, really work on early learning. So we're really trying to let people heal and then work towards their next goals at the same time, and not just immediately pressure them to have a job. We want them to really work on job readiness so they can get a good job and they can get quality childcare while they're staying with us and get those things in place. And then once they start working, we work to establish a savings. They take a ready-to-rent class so that when they are actually leaving, they're going to have something sustainable for them and their family in the future.
Well, tell us a little bit about Maggie's Place's staff. Is there a typical profile or background of your staff?
I think that our staff kind of all have different backgrounds. A lot of people come from different, you know, education, counseling, it could be nonprofit, social work. So I think that our staff is kind of a beautiful collection of different backgrounds. I'm not sure we all have a certain profile.
A very eclectic group.
Very eclectic group.
That's actually probably very good. Let's talk a little bit about the women who turn to Maggie's Place for help. I'm sure that there are as many different personal stories as there are women who you do help. But are there some common themes that you see in terms of their life stories?
Yeah, so the most common theme that we see is trauma in people's past. So we have about 70% of the women that we serve have been victims of violence. We have about 61% that have struggled with addiction. We have about 75% that are minority, and a fair amount that I would say are really experiencing generational poverty, not just situational poverty.
I want to use the remaining time we have to talk a little bit about some of the success stories. But before I do that, I want to make sure that I give you an opportunity to let my listeners know what they can do to be helpful to Maggie's place. For those who would like to help, what can they do for you, and how do they reach you?
Yes, we are currently accepting time, talent, and treasure. So we have lots of volunteer
opportunities. That is the super sauce.
Right?
That makes an organization work, right?
We have lots of volunteer opportunities. It could be from, you know, helping babysit, helping do a house duty shift, dropping off a meal, coming and working one of our events, sorting donations. And then we have our always, you know, you can go to our website and make a donation. Like I said, we are eligible for the Arizona tax credit, and it's tax day. So if anyone needs to get a donation in before midnight, and then as well, just, you know, if someone has like a talent related to maybe a career that they had previously, some of those, it's always nice to get volunteers that have a really higher level experience as well.
So if somebody wants to help the women that you are providing support for and help for, there's probably a place for them at Maggie's Place,
for
and they
sure.
just need to get back in touch with you. Tell us again the website.
It's www.maggiesplace.org.
All right. Now, let's talk. Let's put a face on all of this so that we can really understand that good things are happening, and you are justifiably proud of the success stories that are the result of the work at Maggie's Place. And in fact, it feels to me like it's a family album. So can you share some of those stories with us? We'll obviously just first names, if names are even needed.
Yeah.
But we'd love to hear some of the great success stories.
Yeah, so I have a couple that just pop into my head from last week. We did an 8-week evidence-based parenting class. And at the end of the class, we were having a wrap-up party. So we had, you know, balloons, and we had a banner, and we had the whole room decorated. We got amazing barbecue donated, pies donated, and one of the moms looked around and she said, "This just looks like heaven." And I don't think she had ever maybe had that kind of celebration in regard to her celebrating a success. And then she was sharing a story about how she's working to reunify with her kids that are in foster care, and she had had custody of them the last weekend, and she kept going to the bathroom during the weekend, and she was reading and rereading her parenting book from the class and dealing with situations. And her mom came in the bathroom, and her mom was like, "What are you doing?" And she showed her mom the book that she was reading, the parenting book. And she said her mother and her just sat on the floor and cried about how much her life had changed, because previously when she was, you know, in the throes of addiction, she would be getting high in the bathroom when she had her kids for the weekend. So it was this, you know, amazing change that had happened in her life. And then I have a testimonial, actually, I'll share with you.
Yeah, please.
We have a mom named Charlotte, and she struggled for years with substance abuse, and she found herself homeless and 5 months pregnant, and she called our intake line every day until there was an opening. Recovery was her highest priority, and the staff really wanted to help support her recovery. So she described living at Maggie's Place. She said, "While living at Maggie's Place, I was struck by the generous hearts of the people who were actively helping me when they didn't even know me. The spirit of love and the power of dignity is truly alive in Maggie's Place. Maggie's Place community was with me the day I got off government assistance, the day I graduated with my master's, the first Christmas I could afford to provide for my family without donations, the day I got married, and the list goes on. One would truly think that the tale of a homeless, abandoned, pregnant woman would be tragic, but it was the complete opposite because of the constant support. That hope and love that I was shown is something that I carry with me all the time and try to show each of my students every day." So Charlotte was able to return to school, obtain her master's in elementary education, and is now a teacher.
That's a success story.
Yeah.
Yeah. I watched a wonderful video on your website, which really helps to combine the words and the pictures that are the heart of Maggie's Place. In the video, there's one slide with the following words, which really moved me, and so I'd like to share them with my listeners, because these words speak volumes about what Maggie's Place is really about. And it goes like this. It says, "Love is messy. Love is not easy. It is not always gentle. It is not boring or stagnant. Love does not seek to avoid difficult encounters. Love is not one-dimensional. It does not fit neatly into a category. It does not rejoice in misfortune, but rejoices in welcoming others. It reveals all things, says hard things, and celebrates good things. It shows up to things. Love rocks. Where did that come from? Do you know?
You know, those are sayings that we say a lot.
Yeah.
In our homes, we talk a lot about love being messy and walking in the gray, and how a lot of times we don't have the answers for people, but we're going to walk through the hard with them, and we're going to teach them that there is hope and that there are people that care, and that resilience is letting life knock you down but building yourself back up.
And that's a lesson for us all.
Yeah.
We don't have to necessarily be in the same shoes that that the women who are at Maggie's place are in, but those lessons apply really to all of us.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, are you optimistic? You look like an optimistic person. Are you optimistic that in the future maybe you'll work yourself out of a job and out of an organization? Or does this look like it's a situation that's going to be around for a while?
You know, I am optimistic because I see all of the good that we do. It is hard. We turn down a lot of women, on average 70 a week, that qualify. Mm. So I think there is a really good need. But on the other hand, I see amazing things happening within our community. And I see the amazing gifts that our donors give to us that allow us to do the work that we're doing, and that the time that our volunteers give to us that provide for things that our staff isn't able to get done in the day.
Yeah. Julie, thanks to you and to everyone at Maggie's Place for the love that you bring to the women and children who are your guests through a tough period of their lives. And thanks for being my guest tonight on the Phoenix File.
Thank you.
Well, that is our show for this week. Thanks again to my guest tonight, Julie Carlberg. Please join me next week at this time for another conversation about the very best in our community who are improving the quality of life in the Valley of the Sun. Until next week, thanks for listening to the Phoenix File, Radio Phoenix. This is Stu Turgel.